So a brief word of introduction then, I guess, after yesterday. So yesterday the lecture focused on the relationship between Althusser and Quentin Meillassoux. And I was speaking mostly about epistemological problems drawn from Althusser. So the question of how to maintain materialist position in the philosophy of science, or in the relation between philosophy and science, and then maybe how that relates to, and then the question is how that then relates to politics. And so yesterday that last problem was, let's say, at a very high level of mediation. That is to say, there's no direct political import, I would say, of Quentin Meillassoux's work. Although I was concerned to think about how it might be situated after Marx in Althusser's sense. But so today, I want to go back to Althusser, but focus more on the relationship of Althusser's epistemology to communist politics more directly. And so specifically, just a word of introduction, I guess, about this. Althusser's work on epistemology and the sort of like conditions of knowledge that can be adequate to the determination of any object of knowledge, right, are crucial not only in his lecture course for scientists, but then also just in his thinking about historical materialism as so-called Marxist science. And so the question is, you know, how does Althusser's epistemological orientation bear upon, you know, a correct relation to Marxist historical materialism? And that's, of course, the problem that he's grappling with in reading Capital and For Marx in particular. And so Althusser, I would say, inheriting this epistemological tradition that we talked about yesterday, but that runs through figures like Cavaillés and De Santy and crucially Gaston Bachelard, you know, will then approach Marx's text and the reception of Marx and attempt to sort of not necessarily decontaminate it, but struggle against, in Althusserian terms, certain deviations in the interpretation of Marxism that Althusser would consider idealist. So deviations like Marxist humanism and his polemic with Sartre, or also for Althusser, you know, economism, empiricism, an empiricism that is not adequately linked to rationalism, etc. So what's at stake in this paper then is what that sort of epistemological project in sustaining a materialist relationship to Marx's text, what that has to do with Spinoza, and how there's a certain criterion of immanence in Spinoza's philosophy, specifically in the ethics, that Althusser wants to sustain, and that he in one way or another, I'll argue, fails to sustain, and then how we might think about that problem through the relationship between his work and the work of a more recent theoretical formation, a group called Théorie Communiste, which has been writing in France since the 1970s and has become more and more important, let's say, over the past 10, 15 years in the so-called communization current and its reception throughout Europe and the Anglophone world, maybe in particular. So this paper, in this paper, I won't really stress as directly so-called rationalist empiricism, but what's at stake here is how the relationship between rationalism and empiricism is at stake in the relationship between theory and praxis. And that's what I talked about a little bit in the Q&A yesterday. So just maybe bear that in mind and I can maybe clarify a little bit how I see this argument in relation to what I call rationalist empiricism, or what Althusser calls rationalist empiricism. So the paper is called The Criterion of Immanence and the Transformation of Structural Causality, Althusser's concept of structural causality, from Althusser to Théorie Communiste. Okay, so Althusser commits himself to theorizing the immanence of historical process as it is rendered in Marx's mature work, to constructing its theoretical conditions of possibility, right, the immanence of historical process, to thinking its structural articulation, and to struggling against deviations that might compromise it. So how to maintain the relation of thought and theory to this immanence of historical process? So this commitment to immanence is at the core of Althusser's theory of structural causality and his epistemology of historical materialism. Indeed, I would argue that it is the condition par excellence of Althusser's theoretical production. So let me briefly recapitulate the manner in which this is a specifically Spinozist commitment. So first section. Althusser sees his critique of socialist humanism, his critique of alienation, the early Marxist concept of alienation, his critique of Sartrean freedom, and of proletarian revolt as expressive of human essence. He sees these critiques as aligned with Spinoza's account of determination. So for Spinoza and for Althusser, free action cannot emerge from any origin or essence proper to human individuals. Rather, freedom resides in the alignment of desire with determination. So from book two of the Ethics, quotation from Spinoza, "Men are deceived in thinking themselves free, a belief that consists only in this, that they are conscious of their actions and ignorant of the causes by which they are determined. Therefore, the idea of their freedom is simply the ignorance of the cause of their actions." So that's Spinoza. Althusser converts this argument, or this thinking of the relation of the sort of the autonomy of the subject, the critique of the autonomy of the subject in Spinoza. Althusser converts this into a historical problem. The false problem of, quote, "the role of the individual in history" that he criticizes indexes a true problem: the historical forms of existence of individuality and the determination of the needs of individuals by forms of production. So this problem demands not an empiricist treatment, but rather a conceptual articulation that's capable of grasping the structural production of forms of individuality, as well as the structural production of collective revolutionary activity. So then the question for Althusser is not how the individual has some sort of spontaneous autonomy, but rather how the individual or forms of individuality are structurally produced. One of the points of his closest relation to Foucault, I suppose. So thus, Althusser reminds us that, quote, "the subject plays not the part it believes it is playing, but the part which it is assigned to it by the mechanism of the process." So this is the Spinozist basis for his famous claim that history is a process without a subject. For Althusser, quote, "the social relations of production do not bring men alone onto the stage, but the agents of the production process and the material conditions of the production process in specific combinations." So there, you know, he's almost directly quoting Marx. So not men alone, but agents of the production process. The theory of structural causality that Althusser articulates, that is, of the effectivity of a structure on its elements, or the systematicity of a system, as he says, renders the articulated systemic combination of elements, the elements of a social system or social synthesis, in terms of their structural determination and their function within a relational totality, the complexity of the social whole, the dominance of the structure itself over its subordinate structures. The theoretical rigor of structural causality is aligned with the relation between Spinoza's theories of causation and of epistemological adequacy. As, for example, again, in book two of the Ethics. So Spinoza writes, "those things that are common to all things and are equally in the part as in the whole can be conceived only adequately." And those things which are common to all things and equally in the part as in the whole can be conceived only adequately. In Althusserian terms, it is thinking in terms of structural causality that forces epistemological adequacy and exposes ideological error. Althusser's epistemology of science is thus aligned with Spinoza's third kind of knowledge in the Ethics. Synchrony for Althusser is, quote, "the conception of the specific relations that exist between the different elements and the different structures of the structure of the whole. It is the knowledge of the relations of dependence and articulation which make it an organic whole, a system." Thus, Althusser can claim that the synchronic is eternity in Spinoza's sense, that's what he says. Or the adequate knowledge of a complex object by the adequate knowledge of its complexity. Okay, so this criterion of adequate knowledge that we talked about yesterday in Althusser has specifically to do with situating the object within a theory of structural causality and determining it in that way through the structural articulation of the whole and its place within it. The social whole, not in an ontological sense, although that would be the case for Spinoza. It is not the concrete co-presence of social relations in time, but rather, quote, the knowledge of the complexity of the object of knowledge, which gives the knowledge of the real object. So we know the real object through the knowledge of the complexity of the object of knowledge. According to Althusser, the kind of citing, as he puts it, which obtains in scientific knowledge is, quote, no longer the act of an individual subject, but the act of its structural conditions, the relation of immanent reflection between the field of the problematic and its objects and its problems. It is no more than a reflection of the immanent necessity that ties an object or problem to its conditions of existence, which lie in the conditions of its production. So for Althusser, theoretical production needs to situate itself within the field of the problematic and become its immanent reflection, as if upon itself. So we can say that Althusser links a theory of determination, structural causality, to a theory of structure, to a theory of knowledge. And he does so according to the criterion of immanence that governs Spinoza's thinking of causation or production within the order of both things and ideas. Immanence in the sense, again, that we have an immanent reflection within the problematic field that is the ground of knowledge for Althusser. So then, where does Althusser go astray? Where does his commitment to immanence falter? Deleuze tells us that Spinoza's philosophy is, quote, the vertigo of immanence from which so many philosophers try in vain to escape. And he says, Spinoza was the only philosopher never to have compromised with transcendence and to have hunted it down everywhere. So how and where does Althusser compromise with transcendence? Where does he fail to hunt it down? I would say precisely in his major practical and theoretical error, his commitment to the PCF, French Communist Party, and to the party form. Now, it's hardly surprising to claim that the limitations of Althusserian theory are registered by his intransigent commitment to the PCF, limitations that became particularly obvious during and after May 68. But we can situate this routine critique of Althusser and measure its consequences by accounting for the manner in which his dedication to the party betrays his commitment to immanence and thus compromises his fidelity to Spinoza. At the level of his texts, the weakness of Althusser's position on the party is identifiable in the corresponding weakness of his position on left communism, the theoretical tendency most critical of the Bolshevist theory of the party. Althusser argues that, quote, the historicist humanist interpretation, so the one that he attacks, of Marxism came to birth in the portents and in the wake of the 1917 revolution. In the violent protest of left communists, quote, against the mechanism and opportunism of the Second International. So according to Althusser, left communism was a left-wing humanism that, he says, appealed directly to the consciousness and will of men to reject the war, overthrow capitalism, and make the revolution. And he claims that this left-wing humanism of left communism designated the proletariat as, quote, the site and missionary of human essence. So this is Althusser's account of left communism. On this basis, he argues, again quoting, Kautsky's and Lenin's thesis that Marxist theory is produced by a specific theoretical practice outside the proletariat, and that Marxist theory must be imported into the proletariat, was absolutely rejected. And all the themes of spontaneism rushed into Marxism through this open breach, the humanist universalism of the proletariat. All right, so for Althusser, it's because of the left communist rejection of Kautsky's and Lenin's thesis that theory is to be produced outside the proletariat and brought into it. This is what opens up this rejection of Kautsky and Lenin is what opens up all these errors that Althusser tries to correct, humanist universalism of the proletariat. He supports then the exteriority of the party intellectual to the proletariat against the purported humanism of left communism. And in that respect, of course, he supports his own position within the party as a party intellectual. It is a gross reduction, however, to characterize left communism as a direct appeal to the consciousness and the will of men. Rather, it is best understood as a critical analysis of the relation between the categories of party, class, and masses within the communist movement in a much more complicated sense. For example, Anton Penikowicz's critique of Bolshevism as a dictatorship of the party rather than of the proletariat does not appeal directly to the will of men, but rather to a different organizational form than the party, in this case that of the Workers' Council, as a means of developing the intelligence and practical strength of the masses, an organizational form that was distributed and horizontal rather than centralized and hierarchical. For Panikowicz, the proper role of the party was to promulgate and support the distributed action of such organizations, workers' councils, rather than bringing them under centralized control, so as to draw as much of the masses into the struggle as possible. This was not an appeal directly to the human essence of the proletariat or to the wills of men. It was an argument that distributed rather than centralized organizational bodies should play the primary role in constituting masses as a class. The weakness of Althusser's critique of left communism corresponds to the weakness of his Kautskyist position on theoretical production, that Marxist theory has to be imported into the proletariat from the outside. Panikowicz's position does not rely upon the voluntaristic spontaneism of workers. Rather, it situates the dialectical production of theory and critique within the movement as it is organized and articulated by the distribution of councils. There can be no position outside the proletarian movement from which theory can be imported without establishing a dictatorship of the party rather than of the class. When Althusser accords primacy of place to the theoretical production of party intellectuals outside the proletariat, he compromises the dialectical production of Marxist theory and the criterion of immanence, vis-a-vis theoretical production. The role of the party and its theorists is the place where Althusser's theory of structural causality breaks down, insofar as he implicitly situates these elements of the structure outside of and above it. Althusser is correct to insist, as he often does, that it is not men but the masses who make history. But his Kautskyism turns his critique of humanism over into an affirmation of the Communist Party as the privileged historical subject which is not itself submitted to the rigors of structural causality. So that is to say, to sustain the criterion of immanence epistemologically, the production of theory has to be immanent to the activity of the working class. And in fact, the production of the working class, qua class, from the masses by the activity of the workers' councils as an organizational form. Okay? So this is more or less the critique of Althusser that we find in Rancière. If it was not so before, it became very clear during and after May 68 that the organizational form of the party functioned as a counter-revolutionary obstacle to the dynamism of class struggle. But by the time he comes to write La Leçon d'Althusser, Rancière has merely inverted Althusser's Kautskyism back into an affirmation of what he calls in that text the man-worker, a headlong plunge back into the humanist ideology that, I think, compromises Rancière's entire corpus. In Althusser's lesson, and I've written a paper on this, which was published in Radical Philosophy on La Leçon d'Althusser and Rancière's critique of Althusser. In Althusser's lesson, Rancière's primary example of the worker's capacity for self-organization and self-determination is the Leap Watch factory occupation of 1973. So revolting against planned layoffs, Leap workers took over the factory and continued production under their own self-management. Rancière cites their song as the outline of a future in which the economy works for man rather than man for the economy, and their slogan is, "We produce, we sell, we pay ourselves." The problem here is that it was not the destruction of wage labor or capital that was said to be possible, but rather the preservation of wage labor and the self-management of capital. What the leap workers found out, however, was that it was not in fact possible to sustain the firm's capital through expanded cycles of reproduction without the very layoffs that were planned, and their self-management of production collapsed under market forces. While Rancière heralded LEAP as a triumph of workers' self-management and self-organization, the post-councilist group Négation wrote a text called LEAP and the Self-Organized Counter-Revolution, in which they concluded that the LEAP affair, quote, reflects the end of the workers' movement as a progressive historical force, unquote. It's a very good article, this article by Négation. It's available online. The discrepant trajectories of Althusser and Rancière and the impasses that they encounter exemplify the problem of organization as it manifests itself in class struggle. We can grasp the difficulty of this problem by turning to two texts from 1977 and 1978 by the left communist Paul Matic. The texts are Spontaneity and Organization and New Capitalism and the Old Class Struggle. So in these texts, Matic makes the simple but crucial point that the organizational forms of communist struggle derive from the organizational forms of capital. Thus, any organizational form bears its counter-revolutionary incorporation within it, at least potentially. Capital produces the class, which organizes itself against capital. And the organizational forms available to proletarian struggle are those made available by capital. For example, the bureaucratic structure of the party, unions organized by trade, councils organized by workplace, self-organization or self-organized production within the factory, or the parliamentary formalism of the General Assembly, or the distributed information work networks of post-Fordist accumulation. The dialectical problem is that in order to function within capitalism, forms of organization emerge from and adapt themselves to its structures and imperatives. In order to do something socially significant, Matic points out, actions have to be organized. But insofar as they are organized, actions tend to accommodate themselves to capitalist channels. No organization, that is to say, no form of organization, can be consistently anti-capitalist. And only organizations that do not disturb prevailing social relationships can grow and persist. We see this in the historical accommodation of unions and parties, in the self-management of collective capitalism at LEAP, or in the constitutive tendency of an organizational form like the General Assembly toward liberal politics. Any organizational form, then, is at once a means of class struggle and also at the same time an obstacle that struggle must overcome. And this is a rule that applies equally to the council, the workers' council, or the self-organized workplace, or the Communist Party. So to think the problem of organization in this way, this is not something that I like, but this is a problem of organization, which is a dialectical problem that Matic is trying to think through. Right? So to think the problem of organization in this way is to submit it to the exigencies of structural causality. While the errors of Althusser and Rancière seem diametrically opposed, in fact, they share a common source in their failure on this point. In his affirmation of the man-worker, Rancière falls prey to the humanist ideology that Althusser rightly criticizes. But Althusser himself fails to see any alternative to either centralized party discipline or the humanist spontaneism he reductively attributes to the tradition of left communism. What is necessary is a theory of class struggle that does not exempt either the party or the worker from determination by what Althusser calls, or what we could call, the action of the structure. But rather submits the organizational impasses of class struggle to the determination of structural causality and thinks them in that way. This is what would be required to sustain a revolutionary understanding of historical causality, a theory of structural determination within the criterion of immanence. It's precisely such a theory of class struggle that I want to highlight in the work of Théorie Communiste. So a group based in Marseille, and also the name of a journal formed in 1976, which is still producing new issues. So I'll call them TC, Théorie Communiste. So TC tracks their primary influences back to the Dutch and German left communism of the 1920s. But they also seek to move beyond the tradition of the so-called ultra-left, from panechoic to Matic, to Guy Debord, which relies upon workers' councils as a solution to the problem of organization. They want to move beyond that. So the dialectical strength of TC's work lies in their effort to historicize and differentiate periods of class struggle according to transformations of the contradiction between capital and labor. So a brief summary of TC. They call programmatism the period of class struggle, or what they call cycle of struggles, during which the proletariat finds in its drive toward liberation the fundamental elements of a future social organization which become the program to be realized. Articulate a program for future social organization. TC periodizes programmatism in correspondence with two stages of real subsumption, which they identify, personally I would tweak this a little bit, but which they identify as 1830 to 1900 and 1900 to 1960, two different phases of real subsumption, during which workers struggled over wages, the length of the working day, working conditions, and layoffs, through political mediations like workers' parties and trade unions. It's the dominant form of struggle. Grounded in working class identity and solidarity, struggles took the form of demands which often could be met by capital due to the growth of the industrial economy and relatively high profit rates, and which often had to be met by capital due to the expansion of the working class and the cohesive organization of workers and factories. So this is the situation of working class struggle that that Marx theorized and foretold in its sort of growing strength in the early 20th century. When class struggle was revolutionary, revolution took the form of class affirmation. Okay, so the seizure of state power and the dictatorship of the proletariat directed by the mediation of the party, as in the case of the Russian Revolution. So revolutionary struggle thus forwarded a working class program which reaffirmed class power and class belonging. Programmatism. In the period of programmatism, the revolution is, quote, the affirmation of the proletariat, whether as a dictatorship of the proletariat, workers' councils, the liberation of work, a period of transition, the withering of the state, generalized self-management, or a society of associated producers. Right? So that's TC's characterization of programmatism as the affirmation of the proletariat. The crux of TC's work is their argument that a new cycle of struggle emerges in the 1970s and that its parameters are correlated to the restructuring of the economy after the 1960s. And this restructuring is perhaps most familiar through terms like post-Fordism, neoliberalism, globalization, financialization. These are terms that TC doesn't exactly use, but that a lot of people use to characterize this restructuring of the economy in the 1970s and 80s. The effect of these transformations is a disaggregation of the working class by deindustrialization, the offshoring of manufacturing labor, and distributed global labor markets, a kind of disintegration of the cohesion of the working class. Also a reaction against Western social welfare programs and socialist economic policies by austerity measures and enforced structural adjustment programs. The increased autonomy of capital valorization from the direct production process by the expansion of financial speculation, and the growth of credit markets, which unfix consumer spending from its direct correlation to wages. So crucially, the reproduction of both capital through valorization and of labor power through consumption becomes possible without a direct relation between wages and spending, or between production and profit. The effect of these counter-revolutionary structural changes is the decline of working class power as the dominant figure of proletarian resistance. As Marx predicted, automation and deindustrialization result in the growth of surplus populations without access to labor markets at all, while the collective leverage and bargaining power of the working class is displaced, decomposed, and bought off with credit. The working class is less and less a figure of collective power, as it was for the international labor movement in the mid-19th century to the mid-20th century. To be proletarian is no longer to have a determinate place from which to struggle in the contradiction between capital and labor. Rather than being an affirmative ground of struggle, class belonging increasingly becomes a purely negative determination. The impasses of programmatism the restructuring of the economy, and the concomitant decline of the workers' movement thus transform the nature of struggles and the problem of revolution. So TC tries to theorize this transformation. If programmatism was characterized by the affirmation of class power, TC argues that the proletariat is now confronted directly with the problem and the task of its own dissolution. This means that communist revolution no longer takes the form of a seizure of power at the state level and a transitional period from socialism to communism through the mediation of proletarian dictatorship. Rather, they argue, revolution, or at least the problem that now confronts the process of revolution, is that of what they call communization. So the direct negation of the wage relation, the value form, the state form, and private property through the taking of communist measures as the very condition under which revolution could sustain itself and continue. Thus, communization constitutes the content and the process of the revolution itself rather than its result. So the paradox of this situation is that the proletariat confronts the task of abolishing itself. This is what TC is always formulating as the paradox that they're grappling with. The paradox that the proletariat confronts the task of abolishing itself as a class by acting as a class, at once within, through, and against the crisis of its reproduction as a class. To act as a class today means, on the one hand, to no longer have as a horizon anything other than capital in the categories of its reproduction, that is to say, no alternative program. And on the other hand, for the same reason, to be in contradiction with one's own reproduction as a class, to put it into question. These are two faces of the same action as a class. And this conflict, this rift or écart in the action of the class to reproduce itself as a class in this mode of production, and at the same time to put itself into question as a class, to reproduce itself as something other than a class, right, exists in the majority of conflicts during this cycle of struggles. To act as a class is the limit of the action of the proletariat as a class. And this contradiction will be a practical question in need of resolution, a question more difficult, risky, and conflict-laden, perhaps, than the limits of programmatism. So thus, TC can say, and what has become a sort of, not famous, but famous within certain circles, a certain famous, marginally famous formulation, self-organization is the first task of revolution. It is then an obstacle to be overcome, right? So self-organization is the first task of revolution. It is then an obstacle to be overcome. The self-organization is a limit internal to and posited by the action of the class, right? The class has to organize itself, obviously. The dynamic of struggle, or the dynamic of struggle, acting as a class, is also its limit, acting as a class, right? So the action of the class versus the fact that it acts as a class produced by capital. The dynamic of struggle, acting as a class, is also its limit, acting as a class, and the rift or gap, écart, that opens within this tension between dynamic and limit posits class belonging, and thus the capital-labor relation itself, as a limit to be overcome. So we can formulate the problematic of TC's theoretical production in terms of two related questions. So one, how does the decline of the workers' movement bear upon the dialectical contradictions inherent to the problem of organization? And two, how does the transformation of struggles after the historical decline of the workers' movement transform the problem of revolution? Their answers to these questions are organized around three key terms: programmatism, communization, écart, gap or rift. The theory of communization, as the taking of communist measures that would be imminent to the process of revolution, rather than following from a seizure of power, corresponds to the historical eclipse of the workers' movement and the programmatic self-affirmation of the working class. The theory of the relation between dynamic, limit, and rift, on the other hand, offers an internal theory of the movement of struggles and their internal contradictions, abstracting from the local particularity of those struggles in order to offer a structural account of their impasses and possibilities during the present cycle of struggles. The theory of communization and of the écart come together in a theory of revolution as self-abolition. It is communization which renders the contradiction between the proletariat and capital unreproducible. Right, so the unreproducibility of the very contradiction between proletariat and capital is what is to be produced by communization. Crucially, TC understands the structuralist orientation of their work as an anti-humanist position, following Althusser in this respect. What their mode of analysis is intended to resist, like Althusser's, is any reference, and this is quoting TC, actually quoting an interview with Roland Simon, one of their members. Their analysis is intended to resist, like Althusser's, any reference to, quote, some kind of humanity underneath the proletarian, or to human activity underneath work, which already expresses something which exceeds and affirms itself. Against this kind of model of expressive causality, TC offers an account of determination which situates the action of the class within the exigencies of structural causality. Moreover, they do so in a manner responsive to the altered circumstances of structural determination through history, alterations which change the very form of the problem of revolution. And so actually TC has published in the most recent issue a piece that's on the Althusserian concept of the conjuncture and why it's a necessary concept for communist theory. So they situate their theoretical production very clearly in the lineage of Althusserian Marxism, at the same time as they may, you know, have certain problems with Althusser, but their anti-humanist position and their theory of the conjuncture is articulated in relation to Althusser. Okay, so my argument is that by submitting their theory of class struggle to the exigencies of structural causality, and by thinking through the problem of organization and of revolution on these terms, Théorie Communiste sustained the criterion of immanence on which Althusser compromised through his commitment to the party. In what sense, then, can we say that the theory of communization also fulfills the Spinozist vocation of Althusserian theory? The challenge of fulfilling the criterion of immanence as both a Marxist and a Spinozist resides in holding together three requirements of theoretical practice. One's position has to be, first, materialist, second, parallelist in Spinoza's sense, come back to this, and third, dialectical. So materialist, parallelist, and dialectical. Let me begin to elucidate how TC holds these requirements together by returning to a passage from Althusser's late essay, Spinoza, in which he formulates his understanding of the relation between materialism and parallelism. So remember, parallelism and Spinoza, the thesis that the attributes of thought and extension are parallel, right? That they have a parallel and reciprocal causality between them. Parallelism of thought and extension. So how do we think about this in Marxist theory? So in this late essay, Spinoza, in which he formulates the understanding of the relation between materialism and parallelism, Althusser foregrounds the category of mens in Spinoza's thought, so the soul or the activity of the mind, mens. Okay, so we have seen that the soul, the mens, the activity of the mind, is in no way separate from the activity of the organic body. It's a quotation from Althusser. So the activity of the mind is in no way separate from the activity of the organic body. That quite the contrary, the soul only thinks to the extent that it is affected by the impressions and movements of the body, that therefore it thinks not only with the body but in it, consubstantially united with it before any separation, since this union, which is never a problem, contrary to what happens in Descartes, is based on the infinity of attributes of substance and their strict parallelism. The mastery of the passions in Spinoza, far from being able to be interpreted as an intellectual liberation of the negative efficacy of the passions, on the contrary consists in their subsumption united with the internal displacement of the sad passions into joyous passions. It's Althusser. For Althusser, Spinoza's materialism consists in an understanding of parallelism that, first, thinks the consubstantial unity of mental and material activity through the parallelism of the attributes. And second, links this materialist position to the theory of a finite mode's power of action. Now, the difficulty of being a Spinozist in Marxism is that the theory of substance developed by Spinoza and the theory of modal powers that are operative within it, finite powers, has to be mapped onto a theory of history, right? How do you map a theory of substance, ontological theory, onto a theory of historical determination? This results in certain tensions, distortions, and conceptual transformations, but it is nonetheless what Althusser's theoretical itinerary asks of us, the problem that it poses. The key problem of this transposition is the problem of determination. We need to think the manner in which, within history, the determination of the class by the contradiction between capital and labor consists not only in the subsumption of labor by capital, but also in the inherent displacement, Althusser uses the term décalage, right, of exploitation, the class relation, into communization, the abolition of the classes, right? So let me say that again. We need to think the manner in which, within history, the determination of the class by the contradiction between capital and labor consists not only in the subsumption of labor by capital, but also in the internal displacement of exploitation into communization, the abolition of classes through the taking of communist measures. This displacement, or décalage, I want to note, is Althusser's dialectical word, his primary dialectical word. It is the site of the dialectic within this deployment of Spinoza's theory of parallelism. Right, so décalage, or displacement, is the way in which Althusser dialecticizes, you might say, Spinoza's theory of parallelism of the attributes. For Théorie Communiste, we can say that the theory of programmatism thinks the consubstantial unity of class organization with the reproduction of the class relation. This unity conditions the limits of programmatism, in which the programmatic self-affirmation of the proletariat through organized class power is also the reproduction of the organization of the class within capital. This is the paradox or problem of organization that manifests itself as the limit within class struggle. The difficulty then is to think the overcoming of this limit through this limit in a manner that does not require the exemption of a revolutionary subject initially independent of the class relation, nor a form of class affirmation, the party, capable of transcending the internal contradictions of organization. This is what the theory of communization through the theory of the écarte, rift, is intended to achieve. This theory thinks the historical conditions which determine the structural exigencies of struggle within the present cycle through the imminent relation of the contradiction between capital and labor and the constitution of proletarian class action. Thus, it dialecticizes the imminent unity of class and capital by thinking its historical transformation, through which the displacement of exploitation into communization presents itself as the limit of struggle at the point of reproduction. Communist measures, that is, and the process of communization which they produce are the reproduction as of the class other than as a class, as immediately social individuals reproducing their existence through the imminent negation of the capital-labor relation. This is what it means to think communization as the condition of possibility for the revolution to continue without a seizure of power. Communization is carried out in the struggle of the proletariat against capital, abolishing exchange, the division of labor, the structure of the corporation, and the state are measures which are necessarily taken up in the course of struggle with their retreats and their sudden stops. Are measures which are necessarily taken up in the course of struggle with their retreats and their sudden stops. They are just as much tactical measures through which communization is constructed as the strategy of the revolution. It is thus through the struggle of the class against capital that the immediately social individual is produced. It's produced by the proletariat in the abolition of capital, and not by proletarians who will no longer be completely proletarians by acting as if they were outside. To put this in a Spinozist vocabulary, communization is thus the imminent internal displacement of sad passions into joyous passions, not in an eschatological register, but rather as the concrete historical work of destroying the exploitation of the class relation in and through the contradictions of that relation. It is a displacement of sad passions into joyous passions in precisely the minimal sense understood by Spinoza. So not any kind of romanticism, But rather, Spinoza says, nobody can desire to be happy, to do well, and to live well without at the same time desiring to be, to do, and to live, that is, to actually exist. Minimally, the problem of happiness is the problem of reproducing one's existence in a manner that is not determined, but rather determinate. The theory of communization is the adequate knowledge of the historical process through which the possibility of such reproduction comes to present itself as the determinate limit of revolutionary struggle. In Althusser's sense, it is the adequate knowledge of a complex object by the adequate knowledge of its complexity. This refers us to the famous conclusion of part four of the Ethics, the apex of Spinoza's determinism. Insofar as we understand, Spinoza writes, we can desire nothing but that which must be. What must be, however, and this is the problem, is not communization itself, but rather the confrontation with the problem of revolution that is posed in this way. That is, of course, no one thinks that it will necessarily be the case that communization will take place. But what is necessarily the case is that the problem of revolution now confronts the proletariat in this manner. Concrete struggles confront that problem of determination within and through the action of the structure, which is both the dynamic and limit of class action. Communist theory thinks the contradiction within that structure, the relational movement of dynamic and limit, as it undergoes historical mutations. The theory of communization thinks the revolution in relation to real necessity as this imposes itself in struggle as the meeting of real needs, and thus as the conatus of the class as it displaces its reproduction by capital into the reproduction of social individuals. Thus, adequate knowledge of communization as the problem of revolution also emerges within the immanence of historical process. That is, the theory of communization also emerges within the immanence of historical process. Historicizing communization theory itself, understanding its historical condition of possibility as the end of programmatism, enables one to grasp the manner in which it is itself produced within the rift between dynamic and limit through the historical articulation of such rifts across discrepant struggles. Theoretical production, states TC, belongs to a practice which is not ours and to a theory which is likewise not ours. We are referring, they say, to the practice of all those who through their activities create a gap within action as a class and posit it as a limit to be overcome. This is theory in the broad sense, practical class struggle reflecting on itself. Theoretical production is thus implicit in class struggle and made explicit through the work of structural abstraction from and the critique of the immediacy of particular struggles. Recall that Althusser characterizes Marxist science as, quote, a relation of immanent reflection between the field of the problematic and its objects and its problems. It is no more than a reflection of the immanent necessity that ties an object or problem to its conditions of existence, which lie in the conditions of its production. If Althusser, however, remains within a Kautskyist framework that betrays the immanence of this reflective process, TC thinks the manner in which, quote, immediate struggles practically and in their own discourse produce unfalteringly and within themselves an internal distance. It's basically Althusser's term, décalage. This distance is the communizing perspective as concrete, objective, theoretical articulation of the theorizing character of struggles and of theory in its restricted sense, the dissemination of which is the becoming, the dissemination of which is becoming practical activity. So this is, I would say, a parallelist perspective on the relation between thought and extension in struggle. The self-critical seizure by struggles of themselves as both concrete human activity and as being conscious. This internal distance that opens within struggles is the Althusserian emptiness of a distance taken, thought on a collective level. It is the internal displacement of concrete activity through the relation between dynamic and limit in the action of a class. Thus, it is an immanent distance within which class action displaces sad passions into joyous passions through necessities that emerge in contradiction. The necessity of such displacement is a felt contradiction against which history is pressed and against which we find ourselves pressed insofar as we engage in communist struggles. The contradiction necessarily imposes itself, but that is not to say it will necessarily be overcome. It is due precisely to its imminent character as a process that communization is, as TC often stresses, the most difficult manner in which the problem of revolution could present itself. But as Spinoza tells us, all things excellent are as difficult as they are rare. Thanks.